Penguin Random House Audio presents Hope is the First Dose, a treatment plan for recovering from trauma, tragedy, and other massive things. This is the author, W. Lee Warren, M.D. To Josh, my son and my friend, you're stronger than you know. Lisa, for loving Mitch as your own and for catching all my tears. Dale and Joyce Margaret's, friends who became family in the furnace of suffering. And to all those looking for the light again, doom Spiro Sparrow, while I breathe, I hope. Author's note. The stories in this book are true. Names and some identifying details have been changed to protect the privacy of individuals. Conversations are reproduced from memory, and the dialogue is true to the spirit of the conversations, even if the actual words I use have been changed. Doctors Wynn Lyle, Michael Roberts, Jonna Cuban, and Eric Cuban graciously allowed me to use their names and the shared parts of our stories. Medical disclaimer. This is a book about how to deal with the hardest things in life and still find your way back to hopefulness, faith, peace, and happiness, even if that happiness may look different from what you knew before. In the following pages, I talk a lot about something I call self-brain surgery, and I lay out my treatment plan for the parts of healing that we can do ourselves with God's help. However, there are times and situations when we need professional help to process and recover from trauma, abuse, loss, and other serious life events, and even anxiety, depression, and other mood and thought disorders. Do not substitute my advice for the advice of your physician or therapist. Please, if you're struggling, seek professional help. Prologue. It's coming for you, but there's a plan. Shatter them with double destruction. Jeremiah 17:18, Berean Standard Bible. Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Ephesians 5:14, English Standard Version. Once, when I was a student at the United States Air Force School of Aerospace Medicine, I received a ride in a T-37 jet trainer aircraft so I could learn about the gravitational forces that pilots' bodies are exposed to. This experience would help me be a better flight surgeon, a better Air Force physician. Prior to the flight, the crew chief responsible for the airplane gave me a briefing on the things I needed to know for a safe flight. He walked me to the plane, helped me get settled into the cockpit, fastened my safety harnesses around me, and then directed my attention to the floor under my feet. "Sir," he said in a deep Texas drawl, "keep your feet off them pedals, lest you want to turn this into a real short trip, understand?" I nodded. "Yes, Sergeant." "Good," he said. "And Lieutenant, you see that yellow handle there?" I noticed the U-shaped metal handle just in front of my seat. It was labeled Ejection Seat, Caution. "Yes, Sergeant, I see it," I said. He leaned closer and said in a louder voice, "There ain't no rocket in this seat. Only one like it in the whole Air Force. Just a big old spring. If you should pull that handle before you've reached 1,000 feet of altitude, sir, you will be killed. Do you understand, Lieutenant?" "I do. I won't touch it," I said. He smiled, straightened, and gave a crisp salute. I returned the salute, and he said, "You have yourself a nice flight then, Lieutenant. Keep your feet still, though." He walked away. The pilot climbed into the cockpit, and we had an amazing and uneventful flight, outside of a little vomiting and a lot of prayer while he introduced me to aerobatics. This book is about what happens when life pulls the yellow handle before you've reached a safe altitude. You get ejected from everything you know and launched onto a dangerous and seemingly impossible trajectory that feels completely out of your control and unsurvivable. There's no rocket in the seat. You're going to fall. When the handle gets pulled and we get launched, the inciting event is what I call the massive thing, or TMT. These life traumas cause tremendous pain and invoke in us a sense of being lost or out of control. They trigger emotional and even physical problems that reach into every area of our lives and are, in every way, massive things. Although I'll be sharing a lot about my own TMT in the pages to come, the reason I wrote this book is because you have some massive thing in your life too, friend. Whatever it is, it's your massive thing, Someone left, someone cheated, the biopsy was bad, the baby didn't have a heartbeat, somebody died, you've suffered abuse, a global pandemic destroyed your business. There's something. And I hate to break it to you, but if you don't have that massive thing yet, you will. Some of us feel like our whole lives are a series of less massive but still troubling traumas, which you could call many massive things. But the truth is, your trauma is your trauma. The bad news? TMT is impossible to survive without a treatment plan, just as it's impossible for the T-37's ejection seat to deploy its parachute in time to save your life if there's not enough altitude. The good news? I've spent more than 20 years studying the best way to doctor people when I can't save them with surgery or medicine. And my family has been in graduate school for human suffering since 2013 after our TMT, and I've been taking notes. What I've learned is that it's not impossible to live again. Somehow, God can deploy the chute and you can survive, find your feet, find your faith, and even find your happiness again. It won't look the same, but you can find it. When TMT comes for you, you'll feel overwhelmed, desperate, and crushed. To make it worse, TMT will eject you from your life, just as pulling that handle will shoot you off into space, and you can never go back to your old life. It's a double destruction. Your body will ache, your faith will plummet, and you won't know what to do. TMT is the gift that never stops giving. You'll have post-traumatic stress and its involuntary intrusions into your least expected moments, and an insatiable desire to purposefully revisit in your mind the thing that hurts you so much. These undesired flashbacks and compulsive ruminations threaten your sanity, and there's a real danger of getting lost in them. But you're not crazy, and your feelings are normal and natural. I know because I'm living what I've described. It's been almost 10 years, and I've learned a lot about the natural course of TMT and the treatment plan to manage it. And that, my friend, is why I'm writing this book, because once you have a treatment plan, you'll start to see the light again. If you're in the depths of your own TMT, rediscovering hope might seem impossible. But I promise that it is possible, and in the sections ahead, I'll show you how. I'll share the story of our family's experience with TMT in part one. You'll see that TMT happens to everyone, and it's largely out of your control. But in part two, you will learn that you aren't doomed to be a victim of TMT forever. The massive thing will change you, but you have the power to choose how some of those changes affect your life going forward. After my TMT, I started noticing how other people responded to their traumas and tragedies, and I realized that it's not our experience of trauma that defines our quality of life, but rather the choices we make afterward. In part three, I share stories of patients as they encountered their TMTs and how I made the breakthrough discovery that changed everything for me. There is a reliable, repeatable method we can use to find hope when all seems lost. In parts four and five, I present the treatment plan that I discovered and applied to my own broken heart after TMT came uninvited into my life on a Tuesday night in 2013. The treatment plan helped me find happiness again and helped my wife Lisa and our family learn to live again, and it will help you too. If you're one of those people who skip epilogues when you listen, please don't skip this one. Why? Because in the epilogue, you will hear how all these stories come together to make sense of two things Jesus said that seem impossible to align. In John 16:33, he promised that in this world we would have trouble. In John 10:10, he promised that he came to the world to enable us to have abundant lives. The treatment plan helps you square up these two verses. It helps you know that when the yellow handle gets pulled, the ejection seat's parachute is going to open, even though there's not nearly enough sky below you. As a warning, like in all those drug commercials in which a smiling actor tells you all the side effects of the new drug they're promoting, I must disclose this. The treatment plan is not a vaccine to prevent TMT, and it is not a cure that eradicates TMT and all its harmful effects. It is maintenance chemotherapy to keep us alive and as well as possible in the post-TMT life we must live. TMT is coming for everyone. It may have already come for you, but as I always tell my patients, it's going to be okay. It's going to take some self-brain surgery. It's going to take some soul surgery. It's going to hurt. It's going to leave a scar. But there is a treatment plan, and the first dose is hope. Part 1. When the thing happens that you never get over. Look long and hard. Brace yourself for a shock. Something's about to take place, and you're going to find it hard to believe. Habakkuk 1:5, the message. 1. Where on earth is hope? The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Jesus, John 10:10, English Standard Version. On Tuesday, August 20th, 2013, my 19-year-old son Mitchell died of multiple stab wounds to his neck.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.